Hello and welcome. I'm Mike Scott and welcome to this, the new series, Culture Encounters, Books That Have Made a Difference. In this series, we're bringing together scholars and their audiences in order to explore themes of encounter in literary works and contemporary cultural debates. Today, we welcome Anna Blackman, who is going to consider cultural encounters in relation to white teeth by Zadie Smith. If any questions occur to you during this talk, please type them in using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Please use the Q&A button, not the chat one, on your computer. Towards the end, I will put as many questions as I can to Anna for her to consider. Please don't leave your questions to the last minute, as we may run out of time. Anna Blackman is a lecturer at the University of Glasgow, but she has also lectured at Roehampton, Durham, Newcastle, and Tübingen universities. And she was a research associate at the University of Notre Dame. She serves on the Columban Justice, Peace, and Integrity of Creation Committee and co-chairs the Catholic Theological Ethics in the World's Churches Roundtable on Nonviolence and Just Peace, an area where she has also published. We are absolutely delighted that she's joining us today. Over to you, Anna.
Thank you so much, Michael, and thank you so much to everyone for being here. So today, as Michael said, I'm going to be talking about Zadie Smith's white teeth, and particularly thinking through here issues of cultural encounter and multiculturalism. In 2000, Zadie Smith published her debut novel, White Teeth, and it was immediately met with critical acclaim. But even before the novel had been finished, it had already been generating excitement in literary circles. In 1997, an auction for the rights took place, something that was very unusual for a first-time author. And the advance was widely reported in the media and rumoured to be around £250,000. Extracts of the novel were published in both UK and US papers, further increasing the anticipation. Salman Rushdie endorsed the novel with shining approval, and a huge marketing campaign spiralled both White Teeth and Smith into the limelight. Her publisher, Hamish Hamilton, heralded her as the new Salman Rushdie, a comparison that was echoed by many, and Smith was branded as a multicultural author. The novel was met with nearly unanimous praise for its portrayal of a multicultural London. Michiko Kakutani, for example, labelled it a riotous multicultural drama in the New York Times. Parallels were also drawn between post-colonial novels, such as Hanif Qureshi's Buddha of Suburbia and Rushdie's Midnight's Children. White Teeth went on to win numerous literary awards, Guardian First Book Prize, the James Tate Black Memorial Prize for Fiction, two Ethnic and Multicultural Media Awards for Best Book and Best Newcomer, Whitbread First Novel Award, and the Commonwealth Writers' Best First Book Prize, just to name a few. These two celebrated the multiculturalism of the novel. The Commonwealth Writers' Panel described it as a wonderfully expansive, inventive, exuberant, comic celebration of multicultural life. Whitbread championed it as a landmark novel for multicultural Britain. It was deemed to represent the concerns of contemporary British society, capturing the zeitgeist in new multicultural, multicoloured Britain. A lot of the media commentary also focused on Smith, not just as an author who writes about multiculturalism, but as an author who is herself multicultural due to her mixed race heritage. Smith was taken to be representative of a multicultural Britain, young and fresh. She was only 24 at the time of the publication, even being deemed by one commentator as ethically interesting. In an interview for The Guardian, Stephanie Merritt described Smith as young, black, British, despite her mixed race heritage, and a fairer skinned version of Lauryn Hill, a fan of hip hop. Smith was even mentioned in the 2001 census as an example of changing demographics. However, Smith herself has been more skeptical and cautious about these characterizations. fought back against Lazy's typification that sees her as an ethnic author or an author of multiculturalism. She rejects the expectation that writers of a non-white background should be representative or are inherently marked due to the racial identity, either of theirs, their own, or of their characters, pointing to a double standard to which white writers are not held. She states that some writers, not just me, feel that you're being compared to Rushdie or Qureshi just because there are Asian characters in your book. There are thousands of books about white people in them. They're not all the same. Smith eventually left England for over 17 years, detailing how she had become tired of London's claustrophobic literary world, or at least the role that I had been assigned within it. Multicultural, aging, wunderkind. Despite the positivity and optimism in which White Teeth was received, novel itself echoes Smith's caution. It deals with the difficulties of immigration, the search for belonging, cultural diversity, both the joys and dangers of encounter, and the complexities in achieving authentic multiculturalism. It speaks also to the dangers of pigeonholing and stereotyping according to ethnicity, which Smith herself has experienced. This talk will reflect on how Smith approaches these issues within White Teeth before asking how the novel might speak to society of today, drawing it into dialogue with Pope Francis' Cultural of Encounter. White Teeth is a complex book, spans multiple time periods through multiple perspectives and many voices. And many critics have noted the difficulty in pinning down just exactly what it is about. We find a plurality of forms of encounter between science, religion, different generations, genders, classes, ethnicities. In a very humble attempt to summarise, the novel that narrates the complex intergenerational histories of three families set predominantly between the mid-1970s to the late 1990s in a multicultural London, exploring, primarily amongst other issues, immigration, integration, belonging, and cultural encounter. Main plot focuses around the British Jamaican Joneses, the Muslim Bangladeshi Iqbals, and later, the secular Jewish Chalfans. The foundation of the novel is laid in the unlikely friendship of Archie Jones, described as English stock, and Samad Iqbal, who meet whilst fighting for the British Army during World War II. After the war, both returned to their respective countries before they reunited in the 1970s when Samad, along with his much younger wife, Alsana, immigrate to England. The novel opens during this period when Archie is about to commit suicide due to his failed first marriage. At once, we're drawn into a culturally plural setting when Archie is saved, somewhat aggressively, by Mo, a halal butcher, who tells Archie he is violating halal practices as, "We are not licensed for suicides around here. If you're going to die around here, you've got to be thoroughly bled first." After seizing his second chance at life, Archie stumbles upon a New Year Eve party where he meets the also much younger Jamaican Clara, who he goes on to marry. Plot subsequently revolves around the friendship between these two families over two generations. Archie and Clara have a daughter, Erie. Samad and Alsana have twin boys, Majid and Malat. When Malat and Erie are caught smoking marijuana at school alongside their peer, Joshua Chalfin, the headmaster decides to send them to the Chalfins for what he terms constructive conduct management. This is bringing children of disadvantaged or minority backgrounds into contact with kids who might have something to offer them. The Chalfin family is seen to represent a typical white, liberal, middle-class English family, despite, as we learn, that even they have European immigrant origins. Joyce, the mother, is an author and horticulturalist, and Marcus, the father, is a genetic scientist working on Future Mouse, a project which aims to manipulate a mouse's DNA so that it will encounter diseases at predictable times. All these diverse characters from a multitude of backgrounds are united through their shared setting, Willesden Green. Though Smith has denied characterizations of her work as autobiographical, there are similarities. Smith's mother was Jamaican and her father was white English. She acknowledges that if there's anything autobiographical in it, it's Willesden Green, where Smith was born in 1975 and spent her youth, a timeline that matches with the second generation characters. Smith's portrayal of London has been consistently praised, being likened to the work Martin Amis and Charles Dickens, described as a cacophonous Martin Amis-ish London of curry shops and pool halls and cheap hair salons. She lists this diversity, as she describes the city, through various eating establishments, Marley's Kebabs, Mr. Chung's, Raja's, Malkovich Bakeries. We even hear the city through Smith's use of dialectical speech patterns and the use of patois. At times, these descriptions coalesce to paint an optimistic picture of a multicultural city. O'Connell's Pool's House, an Irish pool house run by Arabs with no pool tables, is Sir Mad and Archie's regular haunt and demonstrates a city at ease with diversity. Run by the Iraqi Abdul Mickey and receiving a comfortably accepted, racially diverse clientele. This has led critics such as Anne Chisholm to argue that White Teeth portrays both a post-imperial and post-racial society. However, in describing the school that all the children attend, the narrator hints at much more complexity. As follows, this has been the century of strangers, brown, yellow, and white. This has been the century of the great immigrant experiment. It is only this late in the day that you can walk into a playground and find Isaac Lung by the fish pond, Danny Rahman in the football cage, Quang O'Rourke bouncing a basketball, and Erie Jones humming a tune. Children with first and last names on a direct collision course, names that secrete with them mass exodus, cramped boats and planes, cold arrivals, medical checks. Here we might see a rich multiculturalism, but we also see the complications that arise with a hybridity of identity, as the children's names suggest. Complications of belonging and dangers of immigration are further exacerbated in a London in which you learn not to look, never to look, to avoid eyes at all times. A London which neglects encounter. These themes of belonging and identity are central to the novel and are explored by Smith through her characterization. Nearly every character to some degree is faced with issues of identity and belonging. Archie, for example, struggles to find his place in a world that has no interest in his involvement in World War II. Even the secular Chalfins find their own marker of identity through their family ideology of Chalfinism. The key characters that I want to focus on are Samad and his sons. Through them, I think we really see the conflict of dual identity and the mixed sense of belonging that comes from a history of immigration. A university educated in Delhi, Samad struggles to find work when he arrives in London, finally ending up working as a waiter in a restaurant of a distant cousin. He is a proud, though comedic character. The narrator still manages to elicit our sympathies in his struggle to be treated as human. During a scene at the restaurant, Samad dreams of wearing a placard that reads, all capitalized, "I am not a waiter, I have been a student, scientist, soldier. My wife is called Elsana." This is an attempt to both prove and humanize himself to his condescending customers who comically order lamb consomme with chips. Indeed, Samad is shown to be, somewhat pompously, more intelligent than his British contemporaries. During a scene when Archie and he are stationed in a tank during the war, Samad rebuts racialized comments from the other soldiers who refer to him as Sultan, being both geographically and historically inaccurate. During the course of the novel, Samad faces a crisis of faith and culture. He holds a complicated relationship to Western society. He feels rejected and belittled by a country which he fought for and which was meant to be a new beginning for his family. Even during the war, he is aware of these tensions when he asks where he should go back to. To Bengal, who would have such an Englishman there? To England, who would have such an Indian? He is unaccepted for simultaneously being both too foreign and too English. Later, confiding in Erie, he further reflects on the immigrant experience in Britain. He states, "These days, it feels to me like you make a devil's pact when you walk into this country. You mean to go back? Who would want to stay? In a place where you are never welcomed, only tolerated, just tolerated, like you are an animal fully house-trained. You have made a devil's pact. It drags you in. Suddenly you are unsuitable to return. Your children are unrecognisable. You belong nowhere." Mad also sees the second generation as becoming corrupted by Western culture and a lack of respect for Muslim faiths and traditions. He states, "People call it assimilation when it is nothing but corruption. Corruption." However, Samad too finds himself corrupted, entering into an affair with the children's teacher, Poppy Burt Jones. He strives to save his sons from the same fate, and this involves him sending one back to Bangladesh. He can't afford to send both. His two sons, Majid and Malat, are complete opposites. Majid is quiet and studious, whereas Malat is a troublemaker, who Samad sees as particularly corrupted by Western culture. Described in London street slang as a rude boy, a bad man. He holds secular role models and later engages quite prolifically in casual sexual relationships. However, Majid also struggles with dual identities, telling his white friends that his name is Mark Smith. Samad eventually decides that it is Majid that he will send back. However, the results are highly paradoxical. Majid returns as a fucker English man, more English than the English. Claire Squire describes this as a reversal of the idea of the returned man in post-colonial writing, where colonial subjects are sent abroad for a Western education. Majid eventually ends up supporting Marcus with his Future Mars project, something which both Samad and Malat oppose as interfering in God's plan. Malat, on the other hand, is drawn into an Islamic fundamentalist group, Keepers of the Eternal and Victorious Islamic Nation, or Heaven, but comically aware that we have an acronym problem. Malat in particular demonstrates the complexities of identity. Whilst he tries to purge himself of the taint of the West once he joins Kevin, he can't quite escape its influence. Still inspired by mafia movies, he reappropriates the line from Goodfellas, "As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster," into "As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a Muslim." He is described as schizophrenic, with one foot in Bengal and one in Wilston. In some ways, it's true in the novel. The separation of the twins serves as an apt metaphor for the split identities and desires of dual belonging, situating the immigrant as simultaneously in two places. At the end of the novel, fates of the two twins merge. Both hold the possible paternity of Erie's child, and both are arrested when Malat shoots Archie in the leg while protesting Future Mass, as the courts and police cannot tell the twins apart. Squire argues that the confusion of evidence and the counter-evidence proves a metaphor for the mess of multicultural experience and the decisions it makes between assimilation and corruption, schizophrenia and hybridity. Smith also reflects on the difficulties of cultural encounter in her treatment of racism, showing a darker side to British society that combats the multicultural colours. There are elements here that are grounded in historical reality, such as Norman Tebbit's cricket test, asks which side the immigrant cheers for, England or their country of origin. Here we see the other treated with suspicion, forced to assimilate and shift loyalties. Smith directly pits the view of nationalism against that of multiculturalism throughout. One point the narrator summarises that it makes the immigrant laugh to hear the fears of the nationalist, scared of infection, penetration, when this is small fry compared to what the immigrant fears, dissolution, disappearance. And it's primarily through laughter that the novel and its characters deal with these issues. The absurdity of the cricket test is pointed to at the beginning of the novel, which depicts Mo the butcher trying to scare pigeons in a version of cricket Englishman's game adopted by the immigrant by using a meat cleaver. More subtle forms of racism are also found throughout. A prime example can be seen in the character of Joyce Chalfin. Here, Smith addresses this through both comedy and satire. Supposedly liberal in her attitudes, Joyce falls back into the old trope of asking Erie and Malat where they are from originally. Malat responds, somewhat comically, with Whitechapel, showing the absurdity of the question. Even Joyce's attempts to embrace diversity are shown as miscalculated. When Erie and Malat enter the Chalfin household, she remarks that her youngest son, Oscar, finds having strangers in the house really stimulating, especially brown strangers, to which Oscar replies by spitting on Erie and saying, "No, I don't. I hate brown strangers." Joyce's liberal feminism is portrayed as patronising when she remarks on the oppression of Muslim women, claiming that it is lucky that Malat is a Muslim boy. Unbelievable what they do to the girls. As the reader knows, yet unbeknownst to Joyce, Samad's wife, Alsana, is far from this stereotype. And we see her depicted in scenes of domestic violence, being as much the perpetrator as she is the victim. Racism is also treated through humorous resistance and dismissal from the characters. When reflecting on the family's move from Whitechapel to Willesden due to the threat of racially motivated violence and the impact of Enoch Powell's speech, although this actually happened before in 1968, Alsana dismisses this as rivers of blood, silly Billy nonsense. The antism reflected in the Sunday Telegraph, this makes racism appear not only ugly and stupid, but ludicrously out of date. Indeed, it is primarily in the older characters that acts of direct racism appear. We hear whispers on the bus from OAPs of the oldest sentence in the world, that if you ask me, they should all go back to their own. The children, Erie, Milat and Majid exit the bus before this sentence is ever finished, showing how oblivious they are to these sentiments, but also infused with irony, as, after all, they were all born in London. There's one particular incident, however, in the novel in which racism confronts the characters savagely and directly in a way that cannot be ignored. As part of the school's harvest festival, the children are tasked with delivering food to a Mr. J.P. Hamilton. Believing that they are helping the elderly, the children see it as unfathomable when he refuses to allow the three dark-skinned children entry to his house. He sees the food they bring as a myriad of projectiles, believing that they have either come to rob or sell him something. Eventually, he realizes the children's charitable intentions and invites them in for tea, beginning a conversation about the importance of taking care of one's teeth. However, Mr. Hamilton betrays more than he intends to with his advice, going on to explain how, when I was in the Congo, the only way I could identify the n*** was by the whiteness of his teeth, imitating how he used the flash of white to shoot black people at night. When Majid explains that their father fought in the British Army, Mr. Hamilton further replies, mistaking their ethnicity, that I'm afraid you must be mistaken. There were certainly no Pakistanis. What would we have fed them? Before innocuously warning Majid that he shouldn't tell fibs. For a domesticated scene, here is a direct encounter of violence and danger to the other, one which Mr. Hamilton is completely oblivious to, but which the children cannot ignore. They leave crying and running to get to one of the lungs of the city, some place where free breathing was possible. Here we also see the key theme of history and the importance of the past. The weight of history permeates the entirety of White Teeth. Novel's epigraph, what's past is prologue, taken from Shakespeare's The Tempest, dictates both the plot and structure, insisting that we must understand the past of the characters to understand their future progression. We see this directly in the structure of the novel, which ends on New Year's Eve, an impending apocalypse in miniature, and begins on New Year's Day. Does this mark days of hope and a new beginning, or a cyclical, repeatable nature of history? Indeed, to understand the end of the book, in which Archie finally acts spontaneously, he's famously makes all of his decisions using the toss of a coin, We need to go back to the beginning of the book to understand his history and motivations for doing so. The freeing of future mouse also serves as a metaphor here for the legacies of the past. The mouse is free to act, like Archie, but it has already been programmed to become ill at certain stages of its life, already inherently shaped by its past, as are all the characters. Within this lingers the legacy of empire in post-imperial London. The narrator warns us not to believe in the myth, the wicked lie, that the past is always tense and the future perfect. We are shown throughout how history continues to permeate encounter in the present day. This is demonstrated when Shiva, a fellow waiter, warns Samad against pursuing Poppy Burt Jones, as with an English girl, there's too much history. When the relationship ends, Shiva directly makes parallels to colonialism, stating that Poppy is not just angry with Samad, but that it's all brown man leaving English woman. It's all Nero saying, see ya, to Madame Britannia. Indeed, when Samad does encounter her at the restaurant, she behaves like the other customers that he sees as piss helmet-wearing gentlemen, tea-slurping ladies on the verandas, cooling themselves under the breeze of the brown boys who beat the ostrich feathers. The question of historical neutrality also shapes the structure of the novel, which follows a non-linear trajectory, jumping between times spanning over a century, from 1857 to the present day of the novel, 1999. We are given historical chapters detailing the root canals of the characters and their ancestors, and the book is constructed around a multitude of perspectives, firstly Archie's, then Samad's, Eerie's, and finally the twins and Marcus. It allows us to see the pluralities of history through a multiplicity of understandings of the same events that are shaped by the diversities of prior experience. It speaks to the fallacy of one neutral perspective, which is particularly drawn out within the novel in relation to the myths of nationhood. Alsana, as the comic voice of reason, remarks that you go back and back, and it's still easier to find the correct Hoover bag than to find one pure person. You think anybody is English, really English? It's a fairy tale. However, the quest for neutrality, which discards any historical or cultural baggage, is exactly what Eerie seeks. In an outburst to the Iqbals and Joneses, who are fighting on the bus journey to Future Mouse, she reflects on the lives of non-immigrant families. What a peaceful existence, what a joy their lives must be. Open a door and all they've got behind it is a bathroom or a lounge, just neutral spaces, and not this endless maze of present rooms and past rooms, and everybody's old historical shit all over the place. And every single fucking day is not this huge battle between who they are and who they should be, what they were and what they will be, because it doesn't fucking matter. It's the past. Indeed, her wish to merge with the Chalfins is a direct result of this wish to find a neutral space. She wanted their Englishness. However, the novel reveals to us the impossibility of this quest. Even the Chalfins face internal conflict when Joshua joins an animal rights activist group protesting against the work of his father. And the Chalfins are, after all, third generation by way of Germany and Poland. We are faced with the impossibility of neutrality. When Malat and Majid are finally coerced into meeting after Majid's return in a neutral place, they immediately cover the room with history. At the end of the novel, when the characters journey to the Future Mouse exhibit, the narrator tells us that they are heading to a new British room, a space for Britain, clean slate, used for the meetings of people who want to meet somewhere neutral at the end of the 20th century. But here we encounter a Nigerian cleaning lady and a Polish security guard. This space is not neutral, and in an attempt to make it so, we marginalise. Here we find scepticism of a happy multicultural land where immigrants step into their foreign landscapes as blank people. We are forced to ask then, not whether a neutral space is possible, but if it is even desirable. Analysing the portrayal of multiculturalism within White Peace, it's worth considering what genre the novel fits into. Goya argues that there are themes of post-colonial, and magic realism, as used by Rushdie, set within a historical account of former centres of empire. Indeed, at times, we see this magic realism when we are asked to suspend our disbelief, such as when Malat and Majid break their noses and encounter the same illnesses at the same time when in two different countries. We're also met with historical events, such as the protests against Rushdie's satanic verses and the hurricane of 1987. This has led others to suggest that White Teeth is primarily a historical novel, hitting London in the 1990s. In Lanchester, in the New York Review of Books, asserted, however, that its account of multicultural London is one that is optimistically reimagined, whilst James Wood deemed it in the New Republic as hysterical realism, which is pervasive of reality. Zadie Smith, however, seems to envisage the novel as blending elements of reality and optimism. She states that it is a kind of fantasy book. There is a lot of pessimism about race relations in this country. I think the relationship in this book is something to be wished for, but I think they might exist now, certainly in the future. We need to ask, is this understanding of the novel still apt for the present day? A review for The Guardian, Sam Jordanson reflected that the breezily multicultural story seemed somewhat a more complicated tale 20 years later. Recent comments from the British Home Secretary, Suella Braverman, multiculturalism has failed, pitching it as a misguided dogma, which has allowed for inadequate integration, certainly seem to complicate. Jordanson concludes that the novel gives us reason to hope, demonstrating that the past also contained empathy. Others may want to conclude that White Teeth is so simply a utopian vision that is yet to appear. Whether the novel depicts something real or imagined, and despite criticisms of flawed characterisation and a somewhat forced ending, Smith herself has even been critical of the novel, it's hard to deny its impact. Only a mere 2 years after its publication, the novel was adopted into a four-part television drama. It has gone on to sell more than 2 million copies internationally and has been adapted for stage. It has also appeared as an A-level set text for post-colonial literature. In 2019, it appeared number 39 on The Guardian 100 Best Books of the 21st Century. So what then is the secret to the novel's continued endurance? By drawing the novel into dialogue with Pope Francis' understanding of the cultural of encounter, I think we can push the significance and maintained relevance of White Teeth further, in giving us both a guide and a warning for what authentic multiculturalism can look like. For Pope Francis, encounter is rooted in compassion for the other, which aims to understand and listen rather than ignore or pass by. This is, as he describes, fruitful encounter, returns to each person their dignity as children of God, the dignity of living. Calls to be recognised as human are echoed throughout White Teeth, to be acknowledged as human and accepted for how and who they are. The placard that Samad dreams of wearing being an obvious example. This also speaks to the importance of authentic cultural plurality, which not simply tolerates diversity, but embraces it. In words that perhaps could have been written by Smith, Francis reflects in his speech for the 104th celebration of World Day of Migrants and Refugees that integration is not an assimilation that leads migrants to suppress or to forget their own cultural identity. Through Smith's narration of the novel from a plurality of viewpoints, we're able to imagine the unique perspective of each character, an important practice in fostering sympathy for the other. But we're also pushed further to see the poverty that society faces when it aims for sameness. Fratelli Tutti, Pope Francis argues that a country flourishes when constructive dialogue occurs between its many rich components, and that authentic social dialogue involves the ability to respect the other's point of view, to admit that it may include legitimate convictions and concerns. Whether White Teeth portrays accurately or optimistically a multicultural London pushes us to ask such questions about the nature of cultural pluralism. One that, as Lionel George expresses it, moves away from the metaphors of melting pot and recognises constructing identity is less about melting down than it is about understanding how to add on and the complications implicit in this task. This is echoed by Pope Francis, who emphasizes the importance of each person contributing their riches to the common good, to build societies that are more and more a reflection of the multifaceted gifts of God. This is a vision of universality that champions plurality. However, whilst white peace speaks to the inauthenticity of encounters and neglects pluralism, at the same time it warns us that it cannot do so in a tokenistic way which dehumanizes. It both challenges us to think simultaneously that ethnicity and origin both matter and that they do not. Importantly, the origins of the characters are acknowledged and not restricted by their ethnicities and are allowed more freedom of expression. This links to how Smith has wanted to be understood herself as a writer rather than a representative. The task then, both White Peace and Pope Francis equip us with, is to find humanity in the other, to authentically celebrate the gifts of diversity without reductionism or tokenism, to do so without commodifying ethnicity, culture, and marginality through the lens of exoticism or excitingly other, in ways that recognise both the diversity and humanness of each person. Whilst this is certainly a challenging task, we are reminded in the words of Pope Francis that we are on the same boat, or as we could conclude from Zadie Smith, we all have white peace. Thank you.
Anna, thank you very much. Thank you very much. That's a lovely paper that you've given today, and one that that provokes a lot of thought, you know. Sue Osler has written in, she said, this is not a question. It's just a memory of what a Jamaican friend said to me. My parents used to sit around in London pretending to be white. You know, and I think, I don't know whether you want to make a comment on that in relation to the book, but it seems very apposite that that's what she's thought about. Any comments?
Yeah, that's an incredibly powerful story, actually. It actually reminds me of something that Zadie Smith said in another interview, where she's talking about the double standards, where white authors aren't expected to talk about race, and if there's a white character in a book, it's neutral. And I think it seems to speak to that, actually, of I suppose what she's simultaneously that race matters and also wanting to say that it doesn't.
Yeah, I'll come to that and again in a moment. If anybody's got any questions, please just type them in, and we'll engage you in the conversation through me, I'm afraid. But that's how we do it. Would you agree, in talking today in the light of what is happening at the moment in Ukraine, Israel and Gaza, that Smith's comments on age-old prejudices and racial dominance in particular, but indeed the novel as a whole, provides a kind of contemporary message for others to appreciate otherness and so reduce hostility and violence? How about that, Anna? Is this a contemporary book, even though now it's 40 years old? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or whatever.
I think there is definitely still a message that is relevant within it. I think, although a lot of the sort of critical reviews see it as quite optimistic, I'm not sure. I think when I first read it, I probably did feel like that, but that was sort of probably 20 years ago. So reading it again, I actually noticed much more subtleties within it. And I think there is a pessimism there. But I think in sort of thinking about this talk this week, especially in light of what Terry Eagleton was saying last week about these clashes of cultures, and sometimes there just is a direct conflict, I think that that makes it more complicated. And I think the way that the book talks about history is quite important here. So I think what White Teeth says is right. I think history is important in understanding where we are now. And I think there probably should be more appreciation of people's different perspectives, of understanding current situations in light of their past. But I think history is also conflictual, and we see that in the book too. So we have, for example, Samad talks about his great-grandfather, Mangal Pandey, and sees him as a great revolutionary against British colonial rule, whereas in academic history books, he's really just dismissed as an idiot. So it's kind of this conflict between whose story and whose history wins out. I don't actually think the characters in White Teeth are very good at dialogue either. So we do see the otherness, and we enter into that through the narrator's descriptions, but we don't see a lot of dialogue going on between the characters in trying to explain their point of view or understand someone else's. And I mean, you could say maybe that's partially why some of the problems arise in the book, is this lack of dialogue. And we do also, we sort of see, also see the radicalism that happens from that, for example, Milat joining Kevin. But we could also think about that there are situations where dialogue might exacerbate problems. When we learn about the otherness of someone, or we see them as too different, it's exacerbated. And I think the book points to these tensions, but I think it fundamentally wants to, I think it still calls us to see everyone as fundamentally human and draws us back to that. So I think, I suppose in relation to sort of the current conflicts, I think, yes, history is important. And I think we do need to understand the history of the other to understand their point of view. But we maybe can't let it get in the way of trying to solve things now. I think it's sort of a both and. I don't know if you've got thoughts on that.
Yeah, I was just thinking back to who we're actually talking about when we're talking about people. And I think that what was interesting in the book is that Hamilton issue where the children where the children go to give charity to him, and at first he kind of rejects them, but then even when he's talking, he's also showing a subconscious kind of alienation from them as well, or about them. You know, that it's, that it is embedded within the culture. So what she does is she gives a relief, but then she kind of says, but it's not a relief because actually it's deeply embedded within that particular individual.
Yeah. And I think also what's quite interesting about his character is that he is completely oblivious that what he's saying is offensive.
Correct.
Yeah. And I think that there sort of have been criticisms that perhaps she fails to take racism as seriously as she should, because it's portrayed in a comedic way. But I actually think she's quite successful at depicting the implicitness of racism, that it doesn't actually not always happen within these big conflictual evident events. It's something more subtle.
Doesn't it kind of then break out, you know, in terrible things? There's a kind of within Britain there's been a kind of culture of a lack of toleration for many years, particularly there's been a lack of toleration against the Irish and against Catholicism. That at one time broke out in violence, going back, you know, go back to 1598 and putting down Tyrone's rebellion in 1958, or trying to, and Essex not being able to do so, and then gets himself into a lot of trouble and gets and finds himself executed. Mm-hmm. But you get that from, but then a continual thing against Ireland and against the Catholics that were connected, were seen to be one of an identity with the Irish. So you see that going through right the way, right the way through, you know, until might even be now in some quarters. But then it kind of transforms when you start to get the immigration into the country from the Commonwealth, transforms into something else. To other, there's another kind of enemy coming within somehow. But how far that's kind of political, or how far it's embedded, I'm not sure. And I just wonder about that within the novel, and within the criticisms of the novel, that they're not, that maybe some people are not seeing within the criticism of the novel the actual full picture of what she's implying.
I think that's a really good point, because I think you're right that that sort of supposed to be going into the boiling point or whatever, it begins with those implicit anti-immigration sentiments, etc., etc. I think that's true. I think probably why she's been criticised is because she sort of the way these views kind of come across is outdated. And I think that at least now, I don't think we can say that's true. I think there's still very much are these centered, which I think there were at the time, and I think she does show that when she's writing, but perhaps it's exacerbated or we're more aware of it now. I think what's challenging about sort of the forms of marginalization that you're talking about, when it is so embedded, is that people don't question it. And it becomes, again, this idea of neutrality. And I think what Smith is actually saying is that it's a myth. It isn't true. Whatever our point of view on it is of Britishness, for example, it's not a neutral point of view. And also there's some sort of fantasy within it as well. And I think she asks us to question that by trying to see it from someone else's perspective. What does it look like from a different point of view? And I think fundamentally that's quite humanizing. And I think she has been sort of critiqued for some of her characterization or a bit of caricature. But I think when she does it well, she really, especially I think Samad is a really good example. She does portray his humanness and his search for belonging. And this is also something that's shared. I think her characters, I don't think they, or Elsana, for example, they don't conform to a stereotype of what we might have about Muslim women. So I think she's also trying to humanize there and say that they're people, it's people like us. I think that's what she's trying to get at in the novel. I was going to say, while still aware of the complexities with that task, I think.
Yeah, but she does that often through comedy, doesn't she?
Yeah.
Right from the start with that.
Right from the beginning.
With the suicide, and the.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, you can't do that. You've got to have halal. You know, so
yeah.
it's just so incredible.
Yeah.
But it's actually the kind of humor that people would engage in. That's what's so good about it.
And it's
Is that?
kind of it's gently subversive as well, I think.
Yeah.
She's not
Yeah.
she's not writing and telling you you must think that. It's not sort of a political correct, but it's challenging within that
Yeah.
humor, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. And that one where the cricket with the meat cleaver, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. It's amazing.
Yeah. I mean,
Just an amazing image. Yeah.
Yeah. And it is, I mean, it is an incredibly funny book. There's lots of moments like that. And I think like a lot of good humor, a lot of it points out hypocrisy, actually. You're sort of twisting something that's quite normalized and putting it in a completely different context, which makes it ridiculous.
Yeah.
And I think that's
Interesting.
quite I think it's quite provocative.
Yeah. Mike Collins asks a question. He says, does the novel address the integration of language and culture?
That's interesting. I think that's a really good question. There's a lot of the way that she uses the way that she phrases the speech of her characters. Not, I think that there's lots of trying to think of some examples that they're quite distinct. So, and there is a fusion as well. So we do kind of see this multiplicity of culture. So we have figures like Hortense, Clara's mother, who speaks in a very a strong Jamaican accent, the use of patois. So it kind of builds up that picture of diversity. We also have street slang, especially this encountered with people like Malat. And that slang's actually taken from lots of different backgrounds. It's Registani, which I can't remember now what the make of it, but it's lots of various different cultures that sort of make the street slang he uses. But we also see it, and again, I think there's a bit of comedy here being used perhaps in a, rather than pointing out diversity, sort of pointing towards integration. So Abdul Mickey, who runs O'Connell's, speaks in a really strong Cockney accent. He has got, there is not, although he sort of is Muslim, Iraqi, that's not how he speaks at all. And I think that's quite an interesting example of this integration. And again, it sort of links back to the questions of where are they from originally, etc., just by looking rather than listening. But I don't know how much that type of language speaks to those issues rather than paints a picture of it, if that makes sense. I think I'd have to think about that a little bit more.
Do you think the critics are always wanting, and maybe we're wanting to do this, but we get a book like this and we try and, as critics, we try and put it in a box, you know? And yet the actual book itself is crying to be let out of a box.
Yeah.
Not to, you know, don't pigeonhole me, because that's exactly what the book is talking about. Don't let us pigeonhole.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And I think there's a real direct parallel between how Smith is asking to be viewed and how her character's asked to be viewed, which is not being pigeonholed. I first read the book when I was studying for A-level English literature, looking at post-colonial literature, and that's the box it was put in.
Yes.
And I have to say, when I read it then, I found it, I for me, it was kind of eye-opening because I'd had a very white upbringing, and it, so it sort of challenged me to think about different things. But I don't think I really quite understood, I don't think I really saw too much of the pessimism in there, actually. It seemed quite bubbly and optimistic. Reading it now, I felt very differently. And I think it really is complex. I don't think it is a clear celebration of multiculturalism. I think there's much more going in there. And there's so many different themes within it. And I think we might want to say, has it been put in the wrong box? But we might also want to say, why has it been put in the wrong box? And I think part of the reason is because critics are trying to look for a frame of analysis with which to understand it. But I don't think post-colonialism, I don't know if it does necessarily fit quite neatly into that. Other people have described it as post-colonial because it just talks about the everyday experiences of multiculturalism. And Smith has said herself about multiculturalism, it's just an everyday fact. It's not an ideology, it's not this, it's just fact now. So in a way, it's just a novel and a story about how things are. And I think that's possibly part of what she's trying to say. I think there's also, within the novel itself, it's kind of, you're right, it cries out against this stereotyping. And in one of the last chapters, it's titled The End of History and the Last Man, so directly taken from Fukuyama's book. And it really is kind of a critique of views that sort of this progressive view of history, but it also speaking to the pervasiveness of different identities and pluralities. And I think that's actually where the book is challenging. It's calling us to be more plural and hear different voices. So I think that I think to say when critics put it in a box, it kind of takes away from that. And I think you're right. I think the novel is wanting to say something. The realities are more complex. The voices are more plural.
Yeah. And in that, it may just be telling us something else, which goes back to that earlier question that I asked you about, you know, the relevance of it now with what's going on at this very moment in Gaza, or what's happened in Israel, and the way in which, in a sense, that our politicians have to try and put things into a box and project it, you know, and putting it into the box doesn't actually answer questions. And interestingly, you know, you make the point that it starts on a new year and it ends in a new year. Mm-hmm. Very neat, you know. Mm-hmm. This is, you know, it's almost like Christopher Marlowe's 24 years, but it's 24, there's 24 hours in a day as well. You know, it's one of those beautiful circular things. Yeah. Anna, thank you. Thank you very much for a stimulating discussion and indeed paper. My thanks also to Georgetown University for supporting this series, especially the President, Jack DeJoy, and the Vice President of Global Affairs, Tom Banchoff. Thanks to administrators at Georgetown, Julie Murillo and Mary Gordon. Thanks also to Mike Collins for his participation with a question today. But Mike and I are talking about this series all the way through and looking at how we develop it. I'd also like to thank Blackfriars Hall for their support, especially John O'Connor, the Regent, and Richard Finn, the Director of the Las Casas Institute, and their UK Administrator, Kinga Rana-Gabnai. And I'd like to thank Maggie Scott at Oxford Scott Education Limited. Our next event, we'll have Professor Dan Shaw from Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. And we'll go back in history because we're going to be discussing Milton's Paradise Lost. This treat is next Monday, the 6th of November, It will be at the usual time because America's clocks will have gone back. We're back to normal time. So it's 11 a.m. US Eastern Time and 4 p.m. GMT. That's next week. And then on the 13th of November, we've got Carmody Gray from Durham University, who's going to be discussing Rudyard Kipling's Kim. So, and then more talks to come as we go through the academic year. Again, Anna, thank you very much for a terrific, paper.
Thank you, sir.
And a stimulating conversation from you as well afterwards. That was great. Can I
thank
those of you sent in questions and those of you been participating today. I'm Mike Scott from Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. You can follow me on X, which was Twitter, at Mike Scott Prof. Thank you all for joining us and goodbye. Have a good evening. Thank you, Anna. God bless. Bye-bye.